specifically in when it pertains to the supernatural. I pray, Lord, that you will raise our supernatural understanding according to the things that you release here tonight. And I ask, Father, that you'll make us aware of things that are in the unseen realm that will make us keen and quick to move in the things of the supernatural and make us aware of the enemy's devices and anywhere he could be exploiting your people. And I thank you, Father, for all the things you're going to show us tonight. And I thank you, Lord, for showing us your heart most of all. In the name of Jesus. Amen. All right, so this one is not loud enough. Can I get a little bit more on this? 11 and a little. This one's actually okay. You could turn this one up just a hair, and then everybody will just make sure you don't eat the mic. And then, you know, if they're loud, you could keep them, kind of not in your mouth, which would be great. So, I'd like to start while you're getting warmed up. Anybody got any questions yet? Do we got any questions yet? All right, there's one question already. Look at that. Here, Jim. I want to start with an impacting situation just to kind of show you how much I like to get down and dirty. I heard them say, oh, no. In other words, I like to say, like, behind the scenes, a moment that impacted our lives tremendously and set us on a course for a very powerful time. There was a moment in which we got on top of this castle, and we were having our devotion, and it started out good, and then it got real. It got like, we're 12 of us, and two people from India joined us, so we had 14 of us. And as we were talking about, unity, we were talking a lot about unity in this particular thing. We were talking, Michelle was opening some scriptures, and then Joseph started talking about how careful we have to be about what we say about each other, even if it seems innocent or jesting. And so about that time, like Holy Spirit just got serious with us. And Darlene just opened up her heart and shared some things, and where she had felt like convicted. And to me, it was one of the best times, because it was a time where we all were able to get honest. And see, church that at least where I came from, we talked about what we wanted to be as far as transparent, but we're all too afraid to be transparent. See, it's cool to talk about transparent and how good it would be to be transparent, but if we're just talking, then it's not really going to do anything, is it? So I felt like that was one of the most impacting times, because we started talking about that, and we started talking about, taking God's glory, because when you're used a lot, and a lot of healings are happening, you could forget who's healing. You could get really excited about healing, like, look how many I did. Or Joseph says, like, I think his ear got better when I prayed for him. You know, it was hard to tell. And I go, like, three ears got healed when I was praying. And it's like, duh, like, that's all you got? Like, and it's not that bad, but it's sometimes like you get so excited that when somebody says something and you can relate, instead of rejoicing with Joseph, which is what I should be doing, I would get excited and I would want to tell my stuff right away instead of maybe a one-upper. Chris, are you confessing here? I'm not saying nothing. All right, so do any of you guys on the panel want to share about that moment just briefly? Because to me that was one of our personal time. It wasn't a real castle, but it had a nice castle feel, and it was right in the middle of Hyderabad, and it was our transition period to go into other places, so it was a big deal.
The thing that was so beautiful about it, again, was the transparency and the ability to be vulnerable with each other And it wasn't like, oh, I'm talking about you or I'm anything like, it wasn't anything like that. Matter of fact, I was sitting in my room that morning and I went to go downstairs to eat, get breakfast. And the Lord said, don't go yet. He said, I want you to stay in your room and I want you to, you said you felt sorry for me. Thank you. Bless the Lord. It was a forced fast, but Jesus is Lord. As I was studying and reading, the Lord was showing me, he said, the enemy is attacking you in a way that you aren't even aware of. He said, you think you've got him just because you're having miracles and signs and wonders and deliverances and things like that. He said, but he's getting you at a tactic that you have no idea. You're not even recognizing. And then he began to show me that scripture in Ephesians chapter 5, where it says let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but only that which is good to the use of edification and for grace. And he said, anytime that you say something that's opposite of grace and edification, he said, it's corrupt communication. And he said, even if you're doing it in a joking manner, and I'd heard, you know, some different things and stuff like that, and I wanted to retaliate. And the Lord said, it is not your responsibility to retaliate. He said, it's your responsibility to love. And that stopped me dead in my tracks. So when we came up and we started doing that, we were playing with, I wish we had the pictures of the confetti. We had some amazing, beautiful, there was confetti everywhere because there was a party, I guess it was a wedding, up on top of this roof deck, and it was amazing, it was beautiful. We were throwing confetti up, and then we started worshiping, and we taking pictures of it, and we started worshiping, and then like the confetti turned into like glory dust, and we're just like getting blasted and falling on the ground and rolling, and then just Holy Spirit comes in and just sits on us, and I just start bawling. I'm not a crier, anybody that knows me. So I was like, that's a great proof to know that we were hearing God, because I was in tears. I'm just joking. But anyway, does anybody else want to share about that? Darlene?
Okay, so that really blows my mind that you said that, Pastor D, because apart from all of the amazing things that God did, to me, what he was doing in my heart was just as big of a miracle. Because when I pray and I say, God, I want to love what you love and I want to hate what you hate, and I want to run from every form of evil, and make me know your heart. And when I ask him things like, expand my heart so that I always have a heart of mercy, so that I am looking and hearing and seeing with your eyes. And you know, when you are a seer or in the prophetic and you're a feeler, you can get dirt in your water so easy. You can get dirt in your water. You can. And you know, nobody wants to drink your purified water that's got some dirt in it. You know what I'm saying? I mean, no one wants that, right? And so God was just showing me my heart. Like the people when I went to and I said, will you please forgive me? They didn't even know what I'm talking about. But I knew, because I said, God, I want to have your heart. And so he was expanding a heart of mercy inside of me. It was painful. It was really, really painful. But I want to thank everybody, because you made me feel safe. And that's what kind of church I believe that this is. And so I want to thank you. But I don't know if you remember, a five-year-old prophesied over me in the very beginning of January. And he says, Miss Darlene, in 3 months, you will grow so much. And this was a manifestation of that growth in my heart. So it was painful, but I am so grateful.
Okay, first question there, moderator.
Oh, sorry. Terribly sorry. So you guys are such a tapestry of testimonies. Like, it's kind of crazy just looking at all of you and knowing you the way that I do, just at least a little bit for most of you.
Turn it up just a little bit, the whole house.
Some a lot. So, and Darlene, I was actually going to direct this towards you, but I'm just going to direct it towards anyone and whoever says whatever. So, I would love to know, like, who had a wowie kazowie, like, awesome sauce kind of moment that just made you get on your knees and go, thank you, God. And what did you learn from it? And how do you think it, like, like today from that, when that happened in India, like, do you think anything changed? Like, do you feel like a, sorry.
Good question. You're going to, Darnisa raised her hand first.
Wow. I had so many of those, but I think the one that I'm just going to pick out was I prayed for a woman that had a tumor on her uterus, and it was protruding in her belly. And so I prayed for her, and she went down, and I was like this. I wanted to see if the tumor was gone, you know. And she got back up, and I felt it, and the tumor was completely gone. I looked at her, and I said, are you feeling better? And she's like, yeah, you know, and I was just like, my faith just went, whoa, way up there, you know, because for cancer to be completely healed, and I prayed for cancer before, you know, but to see it actually on the stomach and totally disappeared was so awesome.
I have something. So everyone, we went to this one crusade. Everybody wanted to, like, get your autograph, get a picture, and I'm like, all right, I don't like this. I hate words of affirmation. I hate people looking at me. I don't like this stuff. And then when we went there during the meeting, the morning, and then we were going to go at night, and I'm like, God, I don't want to go back at night. Those people are getting on my nerves. They say I look like this movie star. I don't like any of this stuff. And then he told me, God told me, he's like, well, and you, when you're praying for them, you're they're just looking at you like you're Jesus at that moment. And that's so humbling. You're like, I'm Jesus at this moment to them. Like, that's just crazy. And then it just, like, I was like, man, I thought I had compassion in my heart. I thought I had love. And then when you go there, you're like, oh, I didn't have anything. I didn't have enough. And then it just, I don't know. You just know you needed more. So that was my wow moment.
Okay, one that stands out, there was lots. It was the second night we were there. And I'm sure most of you have experience laying hands on people and praying. And, you know, you lay hands on people, and they might tell you what their issue is here because you speak the same language. And, you know, you'll pray for the healing and, you know, do you get any better? And you look in the spirit and see if you see anything and listen. Then you might go into the spirit of prayer. Then you might start declaring, and you might do this and you might do that. And, you know, everything you've ever learned, you're doing in prayer for the person. Well, this one night, for me, we did the altar call, the word, worship, altar call, and all that, and then we go to pray. Well, I walked out there, and it was like Jesus completely took over. I am walking through the crowd. I don't have to think. I don't have to say anything. I'm just touching people, and they're falling, and they're receiving what they're receiving, and I might say something like, love, you know, just because it was coming out of me. And that was it. I'm just touching people, and they're getting touched. None of that. Oh, let's see what I see. What do I hear? All right. It was like the most awesome, awesome thing. It was just like Jesus completely using me as I walked through a crowd of people. Yeah, I'll take that. Again, that's like as hard as this trip was. It's like, I'll go back and do it again, you know? Yeah. Today I felt really sad, like I missed the people there. I'm like, oh, I missed them. I feel like I'm called to go to Africa, and I was thinking about it a little bit today, and I felt disloyal to my Indian people. I'm like, it was,
just want to say that all you women who've had children can relate to this, but my heart went out to all the people in India so much that the day that I came back, I was ready to go back the next day. And it doesn't matter all the inconveniences that we had, bathroom-wise, food-wise, eating the same food every day, breakfast, lunch, and dinner. It doesn't matter. I would go back. It's just like I don't even remember the pain of having a baby. You know, a lot of women say, oh, wow, you know, I don't want to have another baby. I mean, I do it again because I love my children that much, and that's how I feel about the people in India. I would go back tomorrow just to love them because it was just so awesome to just hold them and how they received and everything. It's just, I'm ready to go back and give some more love and more hugs.
Well, I just want to say that the main wow moment was as we were seeing more and more things happening, there were plenty of things that didn't happen. And I just like to balance that because when we tell our superhero stories, sometimes we forget to tell about our Clark Kent moments. When you like, when you got the guy who's standing on the tops of his feet, remember that guy? And he usually walked on his knees. But yeah, and it was like, there was a lot of those. And those were the ones that you walked away like, God, what's up? Like, why? Where? Like, you went into a town and healed everyone sick. And I was like, you know, that was the heartbreaking moments. And God said, if you knew that four wouldn't get healed, but one would you still pray for all four disappointments? And I said, of course I would. He said, well that's why you're not seeing that much in America, because you don't. And so I would like to just challenge everybody in this room that we just prayed for thousands of people in 10 days, thousands. So if we went to a meeting that was 300, we prayed for most of the room, sometimes multiple times. Like, I might have prayed for him, they prayed for him, and then he said, oh, I prayed for that guy. So it's like, oh, they were triple dippers. So we prayed for, like, in one church of 200 or 300, we might have prayed for 900 of them because they triple dipped, right? So every place we were going, imagine how many people we prayed for, and then we're telling you testimonies. But I'd just like to say that you can't have miraculous without laying hands on the sick. They can't recover. So I just asked you, stir yourself up, because while we you released the word for healing, Angie's side got healed tonight, right? And it was so bad she couldn't even hardly work with the kids. So God wants to do things. He's just looking for an opportunity. If we can give him a church that will give him an opportunity, if we can give him a people, like, guess what? Signs are for those outside the church. They're not even just for here. We were at one church. They said everybody here was a Hindu, and every conversion connected with the miracle. In other words, everybody that's here saw miracles. That's why they gave their life to Jesus and gave up Hinduism. So the whole church was filled with people that saw miracles. That's why they came to Jesus. So if you think about it that way, instead of it's just what your mom told you to do, like, that would be way cooler. So let's change our thinking a little bit on that. And you guys want to say anything else? I know Jimmy's next to our next question. We got lots of questions, so.
Next question, go ahead and raise your hand. All right, right over here.
Hold on, before we take the last question, Roy has.
Those that weren't here Sunday, I gave a testimony like the first day there. I'd been on a mission trip 2 years ago to India, and hundreds of healings. I seen holes being healed in legs. I seen ears being opened. I just seen stomachs being healed. When you asked them what happened, how do they know they get healed sometimes? And they'll say, I felt a power go through me when you touched me. And so, you know, I'm going at my first church, and like this time, and I'm all excited, right? I'm saying, man, I'm ready for this. Yeah, I'm going to see all kinds of healing and everything. And I started praying for people, and I felt nothing. I felt nothing. I saw nothing. I felt nothing. I'm like, I'm looking up at God, what's going on here? It ain't happening, you know. I ain't seeing the healing, you know. I don't even feel it. Not alone see it. I don't feel it at all. So like I said, okay, God, your word says that we lay hands on a sick and they'll be healed, so I guess they're going to get healed later on, so I'm okay with that. But I'm not all excited, right? So the second night, I'm thinking, well, I'm not going to pray for anybody tonight. I'll pray for salvation for somebody, but I'm not going to be praying for, because God ain't using me that way now, you know? It didn't seem like it. And God had better plans. What he did was, as I was going out there, he says, how do you feel? I said, I feel powerless. He said, then I can be strong. And first thing he does is bring this guy up front with four guys around him, coming right at me. I was going for the guy that wanted salvation, right? And he comes right up and blocks me off, and right there stands in front of me. And I didn't have an interpreter, so I started praying for him. And, you know, I'm not looking for anything to happen. And so I'm going to just pray and then keep on going this way. But God had better, more plans, because once I laid hands on him, God wouldn't let me take my hands off. I tried to take my hands off and move, but I couldn't take my hands off. And as I was praying, the guy over here said he has cancer in his stomach. And his stomach was like this, like he had a tumor. And I started praying for him, and God just shrank that tumor right in my hands. And then he fell down on the ground. I mean, he crashed. They don't have catchers there. So they just go bang, you know, he hit on the ground like that. And I said, okay, it's on. God, yeah, we're going to pray for everybody sick now. So we saw a lot of healings and everything. But that moment there is if you ever go into the field, it's never about us. It's not about how you feel. It's not about, you know, what you see happening in front of you, whether people fall down or don't fall down. It's about God loving on them. And he did that so much. I mean, like you said, we prayed for thousands, and we saw, I don't know how many got healed. I mean, if we tallied them all, I don't think we can remember them all, you know, because we prayed for so many so fast. So it was really an awesome time. That's another story.
In the same vein, before we move out of this, you talked about the Superman, the Clark Kent moment. You prayed for thousands probably that didn't get healed. How did that affect you from moving to the next person? And how can we translate that into how we pray here in America?
We have to realize that God is the one that's the healer. And he will do the healing. You don't have to worry about anything. When you pray for somebody, you just praise the Lord, and you know that God has healed him, because the word says that by the stripes of Jesus we are healed, and that he is the healer. So we know that he did heal. It may take a little while for that person to, for that healing to be manifested in a person, but it will, he will or her be healed.
Okay, so, can I say the one thing first? Okay, so, on this trip, it was completely different for me, and I was really surprised to actually hear other people on the team say this, because when things don't go the way that you kind of think that they might, you know, the enemy is like, oh, it's just you, but a lot of times when I pray for people, my hands will tingle, or it will feel like strong electrical currents going through my hands, sometimes my whole arm, sometimes in my whole body, and that's probably why I shake a lot. This time, it was like, nothing. And I'm just like, whoa, God, you are here, right? You know, and like, so I didn't have anything familiar, in a sense, to fall back on, except for the reality that God never lies. And my husband, he's an amazing encourager for me. I'm an artist, and he told me a long time ago that it was none of my business if I liked the painting, but that my job was to co-create with the Creator. And so it's kind of like the same concept. It's like, it's none of my business if God's doing it the way he did it yesterday or 5 minutes ago, like, because I'm not God, but he is. And so my husband wanted me to share the story about Ruth. Ruth is a woman that I met 2 years ago who was in this house church. And I prayed for three people that has, what did I say? No, house church in India. Got it. House church in India. And long story short, she had AIDS. She was not expected to live. And man, this mama bear thing came on me, and I was just like, you shall live and not die, and you shall proclaim the glories of the Lord, and you're going to see your children rise up, and da-da-da-da, and so on and so forth. And I told Pastor Leah, I said, Pastor Leah, and when she's healed, I want to hear about it. And I had told Ruth that too. I said, when you're healed, I want to hear about it. So when we got there this time, we got to go to this house celebration, a birthday party, and Pastor Leah was there. And I said, Pastor Leah, how is Ruth? She's like, oh, she's fine. She's great. She's doing great. Her kids are great. She's doing great. And I said, praise the Lord. So it's like, you don't necessarily know. I mean, I had no tangible way of knowing how, you know, a woman, she's healed of AIDS or not. You know, you just have to trust God for who he says he is and what he says he'll do.
Next question.
Hi, guys. My question is regarding the spiritual.
Oh, stand up.
Hello. My question is regarding the spiritual climate of India. Did you feel different while you were there? I'm curious because Rachel, you know, when Rachel came here from India 6 months ago, she felt differently here, like spiritually. So I'm just curious, like, did you guys feel as though there were but things present that you maybe weren't familiar with, warring with, or did
what
you feel?
What did she say? What did Rachel say? Tell us, Rachel.
Okay, so I felt, it was different from me because my church was pretty much different, and we had like worship was different and teaching was different. And so I don't know whether you felt the same when you went to the churches there, or was it the same like your, you know.
What, like regarding spiritual warfare?
What I mean is, back at home, they are okay with sicknesses. Like, they don't fight for it, you know. They don't get authority over it. But when I came here, I realized that I shouldn't settle down for what is not mine, right? I should fight for it because God's given me the authority to. So did...
yes, yes.
So did you also feel the same? What, like...
Don't tolerate sickness.
Yeah.
There was also just things from what she was telling me about. There's more presence of sort of like apparitions, like physical manifestations of spirits, sort of like ghosts. And the temples themselves are highly demonized. It's like you can't go into a temple without them praying on you. Like, they have to touch you. They have to do a ceremony. So it's very like, yeah, you're going to leave with our critters. So I don't know what you all went and saw or whatever as far as tourism, but yeah, just kind of curious about spiritual climate.
It's a good question, Matt, but when I was praying there, and I think when we were in the plane, you know, we were praying, you know, as you're landing, so you want to come in with that apostolic bam, you know, that you're coming in. And then we went right into a birthday party that night, and the neat thing about it was that it was an accepted atmosphere, but there was four Hindus that came forward and gave their life to Jesus, which is really cool. So it's like, praise God, we're starting off with a bang. But we knew there was demonic activity. I sensed a lot of the Indian people, they were very shy. So my heart was to activate them and to fire them up and say, hey, what we do, you can do. You know, it's a believer's ministry. And yet the first time we went to India, Roy and Darlene in the house church were saying, okay, now everybody lay hands on the person next to you. And they looked at Roy and Darlene, and they're like, uh-uh. And I was like, whoa, they don't believe in this, you know. So we're trying to teach them, and like Pastor David, I was going to do that one night, and Pastor David says, no, no, Chris, man, that's like a whole seminar. You know, we don't want to really go there right now. And I'm like, well, why not? You know, let's get them to pray. And then at least Pastor David got the pastor to pray for the people. So hopefully he's going to pass that on to the other people in the church. But, yeah, you can sense sometimes they'll tolerate things that they shouldn't. And they don't really know their authority sometimes in the Lord. I don't know, shouldn't say, no offense to Rachel, but some people in India are shy, you know. And yeah, maybe it's just the culture that's there that they were sort of shy. But I was like, no, you need to be bold as a lion. And yet one of the Pentecostal churches we were in, I was praying for somebody there, and I was like, bam, it hit back at me. And I was like, whoa, this guy's a fireball. Pray for me. You know, I was like, you know, I was like, this guy's fired up. And he was just like hugging all over me and praying for me. And I was like, whoa, God, I don't think I'm going to get up. You know, so some of the people there were, you know, bold fireballs. So it depended on the area that you were in. And I'd even heard of, in a place in India, a friend of mine went, that they were preaching, and literally this demonic woman came spinning out of the ground. And he said, Chris, I couldn't believe what I saw. But so he said, you know, don't go into the temples and don't go around there. And it's like, don't worry, I ain't going in no temples or nothing like that.
I just want to say that the hot house, the hot church, hot box, whatever we called it, that I went into, that I got stuck in the corner and I was praying for deliverance on all those women. And I had to stop, you know, because of the dance and everything. So I anointed the first woman's hand. I said, now you go pray for your friends, you know. And when we were in the Baptist church also, they honored us so much that it was almost like embarrassing, you know. It's like, I'm not Jesus, you know, you honored me so much. And so at the end, I said, I just want to tell y'all, I'm not Jesus. You know, it's Jesus in me that you can pray for your friends, you know. And I anointed some of the people's hands there, and I told them to go pray for their friends. And even the girls at this one place, the crusade outside, the dancers, I try to pray for their feet because I'm a dancer. I said, let me anoint your feet. They wouldn't even let me touch their feet. You know, that hurt me. You know, I was like, I want to touch your feet. They wouldn't let me touch their feet because they look up to me so much, you know. And I was like, no, okay, then at least let me anoint your hands. But I really wanted to anoint their feet.
Somebody had to mention that part because I had my eyes down. But I do want to touch on what you were saying, Matt, about the spiritual climate there. I mean, we noticed it as soon as when we got back. I think I was sitting in the van and I said, it's amazing the freedom that I feel here in America and the feeling that's over there. I didn't know how to describe it. It just feels different. And so anyway, the last day that we were there, we were ministering at this church. And it was another hot church, blazing. Help, Lord. So anyway, while we were there, it was so hot, I literally walked in and put my bag down when somebody was preaching, and I walked right out because it was just too hot. So I was like, I will sit outside. I'll see you guys later. So I sat out there and listened to the message and everything. Anyway, I walked back in, and when I walked back in, I just walked in to get my bag, and they said, hey, can you pray for this guy? The pastor runs up. He says, can you pray for this guy? And I was like, I didn't want to. I wasn't dressed appropriately. I was like, okay. And he said, oh, he's psycho. I said, excuse me? They said, you know, psycho. And I was like, no. I don't understand. I said, psycho. So I looked at him, and this man was like kind of shriveled up like this, and he had a smile on his face. And I said, oh, I'm thinking he has a developmental disability. So I said, oh, gee, you know, you just minister with compassion. And I said, I said, in the name of Jesus. And when I put my hand on this man, he rose up at me like this, and he said, argh! And he like was going to punch me. And I grabbed his, I said, you stop it in Jesus' name. I said, you get out of him. That man fell to the ground and just started shaking. I said, get out of him now. I tore that thing up. But anyway, let me continue. At the same church, and ended up the man got delivered, Darnese, it was so funny, she threw a bottle of water on her. And soon as when she threw the water, he woke up. And the pastor came and he said, "Is this you? Are you there?" And he said, "Yes, I am." And the man was totally free. It's amazing. To God be the glory. Well, I go to try and get my bag, and Sean is praying, I notice, for this little boy. This little boy starts manifesting. Maybe 6, 8 years old. And I said, "God, this shouldn't be. Why does this little boy have a spirit on him?" And we came against it. And then I just kept seeing all these little kids with all these demonic manifestations. And something's not right here. So I walked outside, and I was praying. And I was like, "God, what's going on?" And I knew immediately in my heart, he showed me that it was a spirit of witchcraft on that village. It was a village church. And I said, "There's a witch here somewhere." And I told Pastor David. Later on, he told me that where the spot that I said that directly across was a magician that lived there in a tent, and he, we found out later, was he operates in that. So anyway, we go to the service that night, and I'm supposed to preach, and the Lord told me to cover myself because I want to be covered in this, right? And I was so quick, I only had 15 minutes to prepare, so I just hurried up, and I didn't take time to really saturate myself, and this is important to the story. So I go to the church, I sit down, and when I sit down, I sit in the front of the church, not because we were important. I sat there because that was the only place that the fan was. So I sat right beside it. Before anybody could take that chair, I sat there. And I sat there, and I opened up my Bible, and I started reading my Bible. And the Lord told me, he said, "Do not look up." He said, "Do not pay attention to anything that's going on." I'm like, okay. I'm like, these people are going to think I'm prideful or whatever. So I just read and just kept reading. And little did I know, there was a magician that came in. And this magician starts doing magic tricks. And he even asked me to come up. And the pastor told him, no, he's studying. And I said, "Yeah, I'm trying to read the word or whatever." But he asked Pastor David to come up, right? And, when I found out what he did, I almost came up and knocked the man out. But basically, he did those magic tricks where you take a sword and you shove it through whatever. It was one of those, right? And it was just a trick. But when he said that, I knew the spiritual significance of that. And I said, that was of the devil that man did that. So he did that, and he did some other tricks, and found out later, because I wasn't looking up, there was a snake, a cobra involved. It was like a magic trick, like a rabbit. And when it pulled it out, it was like, instead of a rabbit, it was a cobra that came out in the middle of the service. So Pastor Mohan's like freaking out, like, "This is not what I thought was going to happen," and all of that stuff. Anyway, we have a great service. I start preaching. That guy and his family ends up leaving when I start preaching. They ran out when I started preaching. And after I started preaching, we come against that curse and we break it in Jesus' name. The guy comes back. He comes back in and he says he wants me to pray for him. So I said, okay, fine. And I knew in my heart something was not right. And I said, okay, and I laid my hands on him. Again, I said, "Father, in the name of Jesus," I placed my hands on his stomach, and something bit my finger. And I said, "Oh, no. I said, "You're not doing this to me. You're not. Greater is he that lives in me than he that's in the world." And I took authority over it. But again, I didn't take time to hear how to protect myself either. And as he was leaving, he asked me to shake his hand. I shook his hand, and when he shook my hand, best way I can describe it, it felt like ants or spiders ran up my arm. One went into my nose, one into the side of my ear, and it felt like it went into my eye. And I'm doing like this, like, what is going on with me? And I tell everyone later, and, you know, they're like, "You got to, you know, break that. That's, you know, the devil." Well, I didn't do it. That night, I'm sleeping, and I have a dream, and I don't know how else to describe it. I was walking down this hall, and I see this open door cracked with light shining through. And all of a sudden, I cannot breathe at all. I mean, I thought I was dead. So in the meantime, I feel like I'm running in this dream, and I'm like, okay, if I could just get to the light, I know I will be fine. And meanwhile, Sean's sleeping beside me, and he says, I scream my brother's name, George, and he says, I jump up, and I'm running back and forth in the hotel room, and I finally find my way into the bathroom and turn the light, and when I come to, I'm facing the mirror, and I'm like, what just happened to me? And when I asked the Lord what happened, he said, he told me two things. He said, one, he said, you were operating, you chose to be afraid rather than to be in love. You entertained a spirit of fear when that person put their hand on you, and instead of coming against it, you became afraid. And he said, you weren't protected. And then he gave me Ephesians, you know, where it says to put on the whole armor of God. And he said, you're never supposed to take that armor off. He said, but you took it off when you became afraid. And so it taught me a valuable lesson. Yes, there is demonic activity, and we have authority over it. And at the same time, do what we need to do to protect ourselves, because Satan wants to bring counterattacks. He doesn't want, when you start messing with like whole villages and people groups and things like that, he's like, oh no, wait a minute, you messing with on my territory. It's not just one demon, you're getting rid of all of them in one village and one place, and you're being strategic in your efforts to bring the kingdom of God. So I shared all of that to say, yes, the environment, I believe it's like that here in America, anywhere that there is darkness, it's going to manifest, you know what I mean? But the kingdom of God in us is greater, and with that, go in protecting yourself with, make much of the blood of Jesus, make much of the armor of God. Even Sean said, he told me later, he said when we were on our way to the meeting, the Lord was talking to him about Ephesians 6, and he didn't share it with us, and I'm like, see, everybody doesn't always have it. One person doesn't always have it, but you had it that night, you know. But it's okay. We learned from it. Thank God I didn't die. And again, I just say that to encourage your faith. Yes, you have authority, but at the same time, protect yourself. Stay covered in the blood. Walk in love and make much of that armor of God.
Before I went to bed, they said, hey, you know, that chick was demonic. And I was like, yeah, but it was kind of a surprise what was even happening. And then, so they prayed over me. And, well, it was already hoarse from the, like, I got a little sick. Woke up one day with, like, flu-like symptoms, and everybody here was praying for me, so I appreciate that. But these guys, they covered me in prayer, and I want you to know, while Joseph was pacing the floor and freaking out, Sean was freaking out, I was sleeping like a baby. See, Tracy, it's not just you, baby.
Okay, I just wanted to say that the one thing that I speak to Matt, the one thing that I felt there was a hunger. Like when we walked into the churches, I mean, they listened to the word. They were very honoring. They sit still. Nobody moved around. There was a lot of movement or anything. The women all had their Bibles open. The guys had the kids had their Bibles open. The men had their Bibles. And so they were very attentive, but it was like there was an anticipation of God moving. There's an anticipation in all of them. And that's why there was a lot of healings that went on, because their hunger to see God move. Well, I asked one of them, how do you know you got healed? Because it was a stomach virus type thing. He said, when you laid hands on me, I felt the power go through me. So there was this hunger there that was different than here. It was just like an extreme hunger, because Darlene mentioned it to me, and I didn't think about it, but there weren't doctors on every corner. There were no doctors. So they're either going to get healed or they're just going to suffer. And so they believed they were going to get healed, because when they came to Christ, they gave everything up, everything they had. This one guy turned, he was in the class system, he was considered a rich person. He had tons of money, tons of land, housing, everything, cattle, all the stuff. When he professed being a Christian, they took everything away. He had nothing left, nothing. So when they come to Christianity, they give it all. So their faith is like, got to be up here. Just to be a Christian, their faith has to be up there. So they're already psyched. You know, when we come there, they come a-running. Like the village last year, we went into a village that had 10 Christians in it, and of course they were doing a funeral at the time, and David said some words over, and then he gave the gospel, and at the end the village went from 20 people to over 100, and out of those, over 80 Hindus gave their life to the Lord that day after they heard the gospel, and we laid hands on them. So, you know, that's what I felt right was there, the hunger. You know, the dark spirits, all that, that's everywhere. I mean, you're going to run into that. And like Joseph said, it's the first time he's encountered them head on like that. You know, but you're going to find that anywhere. But what I really felt there was the hunger for these people to really receive God and his love manifesting through healing. So.
Papa Roy, your response actually goes right into my question. I wanted to ask you guys, like, how does it affect you going somewhere where there's such a hunger, there's such a pull and a desire and a zeal for the things of God, and then you come back to the people who so easily have it available and that they don't take full advantage of what God has for them?
We kind of touched on the birthday party that we went to, but like the hunger there, they give opportunities for people to pray for people, to share the gospel at a birthday party, whereas here all we care about is what am I getting? What am I going to get from this person? What am I going to get from that person? And the thing is their hunger is, God, how can you bless me? How can you reach the rest of my family? Let's praise God before we cut cake. Or like when we got invited to a wedding, that we were only there to literally pray for the couple and then eat food. And we didn't know them. And they were like, can you just pray for us? And then let's snap a picture with you. And it was just like, they opened their hearts to letting God move in every aspect of their lives. Every celebration, it's about letting God move. Not, hey, what about me?
I just want to say that, just realize that when you're on a missions trip, we're giving you church to church, highlight to highlight. If we went down to the town, they're doing the same thing we're doing on the workplace, okay? Everybody's focused on work, making money, they're hustling, they're doing all this stuff we're doing. So some ways you just gotta see what we're talking about. It's like we're going from church to church. We're going to a church-centered birthday now this is where it's different. The churches were intentional about the gospel. Now, our church is hungry, but our church needs to be more intentional about the gospel, getting to their family members so that all their family members can be saved. That's what they were good at. They would invite their family. The one testimony I had was the guy was Hindu. He was an alcoholic. He wasn't saved. He was abusive. He came to the church because his wife said, I really want you to come tonight. It's a big deal for me. So it's really all about us turning the corner on having a little party for ourselves to a place where we're having an impact in our families or our workplaces because we're bringing those people to a place to encounter God. So it's really not a lot different except for our intentionality about the people around us getting touched and not just us getting touched, me getting my breakthrough, me getting my blessing, me getting my healing, me getting this, me getting that. It's more about my family getting it, my coworkers getting it, my town changing, so it's a lot more kingdom mindset. So I think that's really where we got to focus, and then we'll easily be there because the hunger is there. We just need to be hungry for the people around us, not for ourselves.
If I understand your question correctly, as you're saying, sometimes when you go out and then you come back, sometimes it's a letdown sometimes. Did you mean that? I mean, well, one of the things that I've always felt, even when I came home, is whenever you step out for God and you go on a missions trip and you're intentional, you want to preach the gospel. Because I had some people that asked me, oh, did you feed the poor? Did you build a church physically? And I said, no, we didn't do any of that. Actually, we preached the gospel. We prayed for people. We loved on them. And we saw God do miracles and touch people's lives. And not saying that people that feed the poor and build churches, that that's wrong. That's love, and that's you know, God too. But I said that wasn't really what our missions trip was. But the beauty to me is that it builds your faith when you go on a missions trip and you see God move, because I think when you step out, but then even when I came right back, one of the things is that most of the places we went, you can't go into the highways and byways in India because we're really tourists. So people came to us. So it's a little easier. Whereas here, I've been convicted since I've been home. I've only preached the gospel once. Hopefully everyone's been more intentional to get out. And one of the things that convicts me, the Pastor David says, we need, the Bible says, go ye into all the world. It doesn't say invite them to church. It doesn't say that, you know, come in and have a rah, rah, rah and praise the Lord and don't worry about those. And on my job, I ran into this woman that, you know, I just said, hey, can I pray for you about something? And she looked at me real angry and said, yeah, I'm going through hell. I was like, whoa, you know. But she didn't want to share everything with me. And she's, oh, yeah, and by the way, I've got a sinus infection. I was like, cool, let me pray for you. And I went to pray for her, and she says, well, I'm in a hurry. And I says, well, go, and I'll pray for you. But, you know, people are hurting everywhere.
Right.
They're hurting here. They're hurting in India. And people need prayer. But if you're not available, you know, because a lot of my friends, I try and convict them, and they convict me. And I said, hey, have you shared the gospel, good news with anyone? They said, I'm doing it all the time, bro. I said, no, I mean intentionally. Did you go out for an hour, a half an hour, or even pray for the sick? And one of the things that I love on every missions trip, I felt it this one, but the one 2 years ago, I had gotten sick, and then I realized I was healed. And I was there eating, you know, the fried donut with the spices in it. And I was eating it freely and not in fear. And all of a sudden, I felt God telling me, people back in Maryland have been praying for it. And I just started to weep, you know. And Roy or somebody looked at me, what's wrong with you? And I was like, people are praying for me back in Maryland. Yes! You know? And it was exciting to know that your prayers helped. So I just wanted to thank you all for your prayers because you were there with us.
I just want to say something about the evangelism.
Oh, okay. I have a question. I have a question. You all share very good collective experiences. I'm wondering if you began to give any thought about each one of you have had different nuggets that you talked about. Is there something that sticks out in your mind that could be benefit to the home base, so to speak, that will help us to continue to progress? You know, Pastor, you said earlier when we started that we need to, the kingdom of God suffers violence and the violent take it by force. And so we got to go forward and possess our possession, if you will. Does any nugget stick out that would help that you've learned where you've been a blessing to others, but each time you're a blessing to someone else, you typically receive something as well. So I'm wondering what you collectively, maybe it takes some thought that you've received something that's going to help you get benefit to help God advance the kingdom here.
Okay, well, I was just going to share that. And God just brought it to my mind again, the evangelizing. Mm-hmm. When we were on the plane, I thought, okay, we're just going to go home. I'm just going to relax and everything. And I started talking to the guy next to me, and he was Hindu. I said, oh, so, you know, what religion are you? And he says, oh, I'm Hindu. And I said, oh, okay. I said, I'm Christian. And we just started talking. And finally, I said, I'm not going to go to jail now. I'm telling them everything. So I started telling them. I started telling him that why I was there, and he started telling me that when he was a little boy, missionaries came to his village and planted a seed with him. And his parents, you know, were so into the idols and everything, you know. And there was so much abuse there. And God showed me so much abuse in the villages, you know. So then he starts telling me, very, very nice guy, you know. I didn't push anything on him. He starts telling me, he's like, so what do you do about all that hurt? How do you let go of the hurt? And so I was like, can I pray for you? So I laid my hand on his heart, and I started praying for his heart, you know. And afterwards, I said, how do you feel? He goes, I feel so much lighter. And then he was. And I said, I just have to tell you that God wants you to know this. Forgive them, for they don't know what they've not. They know not what they've done. I said it was a generational thing. His mother threw his wife down the stairs. This man went all the way to India to get his money out of the bank, did not even leave the airport, got back on the plane and flew back with us. And it was such a privilege to sit there and talk with him. And he told me he loved the music and everything. And so after I prayed with him, I said, are you ready to know Jesus now? He said, yes, I am. And I led him to Christ. And it was so awesome, because I was like, whoa, I knew that I was going to lead him to Christ when I sat next to him. I just knew it. God just showed me, you know. And he showed me pictures of his wedding. And he said that his wife got cancer, and that God healed her of cancer. And then she was able to have twins afterwards. So he was praying to God, and he didn't even know Jesus. So hopefully we pray that he comes to the church. He lives in Virginia.
So it's being more bold and sharing your faith. Yeah.
Nugget number one.
Right.
So sometimes you'd be praying for people, and they just look at you with these eyes like, you don't have any, like you don't have anything. And I was like, Roy told me one thing. He's like, when people look at me like that, I tell them to get their eyes off of me, because I don't have anything, to get their eyes on Jesus. And then Michelle had this vision one time. She said she seen it like football. Like, I'm gonna tell you all about football, and then I'm like, you ready to play? And you're like, yeah, yeah. And then I throw the football at you and hit you in the face, because you don't know how to receive. So there's a big, like, a lot of people didn't know how to receive. You're praying, and they're just looking at you. So I would say one of the biggest nuggets is, even sometimes here in America, people will be, like, you'll be praying for them, and they'll just look at you. Don't look at me. I don't have anything. If you just keep your eyes on Jesus and know that he's the one who's going to heal you and not me, then you'll receive it.
Good. Step out. There's times that you don't want to share, say, personal testimonies.
Yeah.
I'm one of those people. But God made me step out. And when I did, I saw so many women come up to me that their hearts were just breaking, and God was healing it. So you need to step out in faith. God will lead you, and just trust him.
I just want to say that one important thing is loving.
Right.
Stopping to listen to what somebody has to say and really caring and taking the time, you know, because there's a lot, everybody's hurting out there. Everybody, I mean, has their issues, and you know, giving them a smile, a hug, an encouragement. You know, because everybody needs love. So it's not just love the one you're with. It's love everybody.
Well, my nugget's pretty quick. That it was really silly, because as I was laying hands, I was realizing how many people you're praying for here. If it was just like, if you would do the same wherever you go, you'd see the same results. And so many people say, like, oh, you know, I wish we could see this in America. Well, did you pray for 1,000 people in 10 days in America? Did you? Like, if we did that here, I believe that we'd see the same thing. But you have to actually do that to see the same thing. It's not fair to relate an atmosphere. The atmosphere you're supposed to be carrying, right? You're an embassy. That means everything above you and beneath you is all heaven. That's what an embassy does, right? Everything above and beneath me what I carry is heaven. So I have to actually go into the world. I have to actually lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. So if I was batting 20% or one-third or whatever, like, I have to actually pray for three people to see one healed. And, you know, we got to see some people get healed in the church just since we've been back. But that's supposed to be regular, taking place, and we don't want to take it lightly, but we have to be intentional. Okay, so go and be intentional. If you've got, we're gonna release some of that tonight, because I felt like we're gonna have to wrap up, but I felt like we need to just release impartation, and then you need to actually go use it. Use it while it's fresh. Drop it while it's hot, like it's hot. Drop it like it's hot, Joseph.
Oh, I just thought about a rap, but I'm not gonna rap. I was gonna drop it like it's hot that way, but y'all know I'm not black, so I'm joking. Anyway, it was funny you said that, because that set what you said set up for the nugget that I had. When we were there, we were doing devotionals every day and worshiping and stuff. And one particularly, one day particular, I think was our first devotion, the Lord showed me that he was showing me the importance of living intentionally and staying focused on the mission. And he showed me Jesus, and he said Jesus did not waste time with idle talk. He did not waste time like, oh, I'm going to talk to this person, I'm going to do this, I'm going to watch TV, I'm going to go on this vacation, I'm going to do this, I'm going to do that. No, he was intentional in every single thing that he did. And when he was done, he left the earth. And he was showing me that's the example for which you're supposed to live. He's like, don't waste time on things that aren't eternal, that don't matter. The value of the soul is more important than you watching TV. The value of the soul or the healing of the heart is more important than you wanting to do this or do that. And I'm not saying that God doesn't allow us to do things. Thank God he does. Thank God for TV and vacations and things like that. But more importantly than that is to live intentionally, is to stay focused on the mission until the mission is done. And then once it's done, you're done. Paul said that. He said, what else is left? It's better to go home and be with the Lord. Amen.
Well, it was many things, because this is my first time going to India. And what hit me the most was the unity between everybody and the friendliness between them and the love that they had. Not only the people that I was with, but the people of India themselves.
So I would say my major nugget was probably would be to know who you are, whose you are, and what the word says that you have. Because, like, for example, one of the things I would say that made me sad in the church was, it's okay for Sister Nini over there to be full-on possessed. Like, that's just who she is. She's just full-on possessed, and she can flare up anytime she wants. Well, you know what? That's not okay. So I think we need to, like, live like, yes, this is who God says we are. This is what God says we have. This is the what the word tells us to do. And always keep your yes button on. You know, like, I don't care. Like, I asked God, I said, God, when he gave me the privilege of partnering with him in having a lot of deaf ears open, which was amazing to me, I said, God, I always want to hear you. Well, he tested that, like, straight up, right off. Like, I want to be asleep at 3:30 in the morning in India on my hard, made out of a box bed. Hallelujah. But he's like, no, I want to talk to you about where you're going 4.5 hours away, and you're only going to get 43 minutes of sleep, and it's not even going to be good. Okay, huh. So, you know, like, keep your yes on, because you don't know if that word that you're going to drop is something that they've been praying for a whole year. Always keep your yes on. That's my nugget.
Okay. Real quick, it's just believe. Our whole trip, everyone in here can give a testimony where we had to have faith. We had to have faith for the money. We had to have faith for the visas. We had to have faith for the airplane. We had to have faith when we got there. Everything was about faith. Jesus said, you believe because you've seen, but blessed are those that believe and haven't seen. And we had a lot of tests. We didn't see the visas, but we had to believe they were coming. We didn't have the money, but we had to believe it was coming. We didn't have water. We had to believe it was coming. So everything is about belief. And it's not just on a mission trip, but you can, it really intensifies on a mission trip. But even in our daily lives, it's all about believing God's word. Not what we're seeing, hearing, or feeling, but believing his word for us.
Back here, just take this back here, Miss Ann. I'll grab yours right here. Just drag them right back. We're gonna just line up and pray. We just want to release whatever the Lord gave us. Basically, you know, it's a 10-day intensive, and I believe that the Lord wants to do the same thing here. And I believe all we have to do is be intentional about what we're doing in America. So. I told this one story. I said, who has relatives in America, or who has relatives that are not saved? And then I quoted Acts 16:31, that it's a promise that all your household shall be saved. In other words, the first mission of every believer is to believe on Jesus Christ and then get your whole family to believe on Jesus Christ. Step one, if you haven't gotten that step done, keep working on it, because sometimes for me it was very hard because my sister pressed all my buttons to prove Jesus in my life, because we had a lot of familiarity, we had a lot of history, so our history was coming against my faith, and eventually my faith rose up. My niece ended up getting saved, then my sister automatically got saved, and then my parents got saved, then my brother got saved. And that's how it's supposed to work. We have to actually be intentional about everyone around us being saved. And almost, sadly enough, almost everybody in the church raised a hand and said, I know somebody in my family that's not saved. That's unacceptable, because the promises of God are you and your household shall be saved. Everybody. So we can reach out further. If you got your immediate family saved, let's reach out beyond that. Or let's reach into the workplace and just reach into there and start stirring up that, because God wants to use you in such a way. And I like what Teresa said, was that keeping your love on, or always loving. Everyone needs love. So even if you pray for somebody, there was a guy at my work that had cancer. And I told him when he got back, I said, I prayed for you. God brought you into my remembrance multiple times. And I said, I just prayed for you because I wanted to see, I know it was tough what you're going through, because it wasn't about his healing. It was about somebody cared for him at that time, because that's how it was. I didn't even know him. I barely met him. So let's everybody stand at once prayer, and let's turn that up, and we're just going to do break every chain again. All right. Well, here we go. Release the anointing, Lord. Just thank you for everything you're going to do. I pray for imparting everything that we have, Lord, silver and gold. Have we not enough? But we just thank you, Lord, for everything we do have being released in Jesus' name. Come on up as you feel led.
The only thing I wanted to share is that one of the nuggets that God gave me is don't tolerate anything in your life that isn't God. Don't tolerate it.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Come on, army of the Lord, raise it.
There is power in the name of Jesus.
Now I raise power.
every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Woo! To break every chain, break every chain, break every chain. Come on, Tim, sing. Every time.
yes.